Yes, sir, the screen is visible.
Okay,
yes,
can
sir,
you see that?
Visible.
Visible.
Yes, sir, we can see it.
Okay, fantastic. Okay, so you know, last time we had just started this introduction to the SSB procedure, and we had gone through, you know, some parts. I will just quickly rush through those slides, and then we will come to the actual place point where we had stopped last time. So we had talked about what SSB is all about, how it is a scientific process. Then we had talked about the steps in terms of, you know, getting a call letter, how you are all happy when you get a call letter, and then, you know, how that happiness suddenly turns into something more serious because you realize that you do study so much and prepare so much, to maybe the different feelings from where you clear the stage one to the psych test, GTO task, interview. And we had discussed this part also as to how people, because of their experiences, build up different perceptions which may not necessarily be true. And we had discussed this story about the blind man and the elephant. And I had explained that our aim, you know, through this 2 weeks process, is essentially to remove this putty which is there on your eyes, such that all of you are, you know, able to see the elephant as it is, essentially understand what the SSB is really all about. And then we had discussed about the different myths and rumors that surround the SSB aspects. Okay, we had discussed about why rejection center, when are you observed, as to why maybe reading from guides does not really help. So is everyone on the page here with me? Ajinkya, you
yes,
had missed this part last time, I think, because you were not there on the session.
Yes, sir.
But doesn't matter. From here on, what we are going to do is we are going to take on the complete SSB process. I think that is also equally important. And anyways, you know, when we resume classes, we will be running through these things again anyways. Okay, so my aim is to sort of help you understand this a little earlier. So can we move ahead from here now? Sharvari, Priyanka, can you respond?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So everyone is able to see the photograph?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, perfect. Okay.
Yes, sir.
So what is this photograph about, Sharvari? Yeah.
So this is a picture from Mahabharat.
Yeah, what is happening? What is happening in the picture? Why is this picture so famous? Why is this photograph seen in many places? What is the relevance?
Sir, maybe it's the picture where Krishna is telling the Krishna is telling Gita that version, maybe.
Yeah, maybe no, it is that. Why are you saying maybe? Absolutely, you're right, absolutely right. It is that. It is about, you know, this incident in the Mahabharata, where, you know, the battle at Kurukshetra is about to start. And when this battle is about to start, that is the time when Arjuna says that, you know, I want to go closer to the enemy ranks when they are all lined up on either sides of the battlefield, and I want to see the enemy once closely. And when he goes close, he finds that everyone there is someone whom he knows, and they are all maybe his brothers, his gurus, the elders. You know, he sees Bhishma there, he sees Guru Drona there, and at that point of time, you know, he gets confused. Okay. So do you know Ajinkya, do you think, you know, Arjuna had all the qualities of a good warrior?
Yes, sir.
Yes?
Then, sir.
Why do you think at this particular stage in battle, Arjuna got confused?
Sir, actually, I don't know the whole Mahabharata. Yeah, yes, I haven't heard
You haven't heard it. About this whole incident about the, you know, Priyanka?
Yes, sir. So can you hear me?
Yeah.
Okay. Sir, actually, Arjuna had to fight against his own people. So yeah. He was not ready. But I think the lesson from this, what we can learn is, we have to fight against our own, for example, bad habits or our, yes. But then we need a mentor for that, a right direction maybe.
Okay.
And Shri Krishna is guiding him.
Hello. Can you hear me, sir?
I can hear
you. All others are also able to hear me?
Yes, sir.
Actually, okay, yes, Sameer explains this slide much, much better than me. So I want him to maybe explain it to all of us.
Achha, this picture is about Mahabharata. Okay, and the situation is ki the war is about to start. Okay, and there is Lord Krishna, there is Arjun. And Arjun has got all the capabilities to become to be the best, and he is the most qualified person to fight the war, the best archer ever. But when the time comes actually to fight the war, Arjuna is not even able to raise his bow and arrow. And why this is happening? It is because his mind is not clear. So the clarity of the mind is absolutely very, very important. If you want to do well, not only in the war, even in the SSB. Okay, so all of you should understand this first, that you should be absolutely clear as to what SSB is, what is it that is required in the SSB, so that you are able to perform accordingly. Okay, clarity of the mind. Having all the qualifications will not help. Like Arjun was fully qualified to fight this war. There was no one better than Arjun. But still, when the time came, he was ineffective. Why? Because clarity of mind is not there. So all of you in our next sessions and all, we'll try to see to it that you are very, very clear and you get an absolute dicto exposure what happens in the SSB. The same to same process is done in the classes, even during the classes and even on this online sessions. You can continue, sir. Yeah, yeah. I think all of them have understood this.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, you know, one more aspect about this picture is, you know, Krishna explaining to Arjuna that it is his dharma to fly fight. Okay, that is what Krishna tells Arjuna, that you know it is your dharma to fight. And many times, what I found is that people tend to confuse this word dharma with religion. Okay, but as per me, again, I don't know, I'm not a scholar on the Bhagavad Gita, but as per me, it is that dharma is not religion. That dharma, as per me, is the duty that you are required to do. So if it is a fight against of good against evil, then it is your duty to fight evil in society. It is your duty to fight against the bad things in society. So, you know, many times people tend to confuse this very happily, saying that there is a religious context to this. You know, for me, essentially, it is about doing the right things socially, which are right, and fighting against evil. And dharma is duty. In the Bhagavad Gita, wherever there is a mention of dharma, it is more in the context of doing one's duty than in the context of any religion. But of course, you can always, check it from people who are better qualified on the Gita. My interpretation from a little bit what I know was this. Okay, so let's move ahead. What we are going to cover is, what is the selection procedure all about? How is it actually done? That is, what are the tests involved? And how should you prepare? So what is the part that you can start preparing? Essentially, this is something that will help you, because a lot of us are going to be maybe quarantined in some way for the next 10 to 15 days. So maybe a little bit idea about how we can start preparing. I think it will be helpful for everyone. Okay. First and foremost, the difference between, you know, the corporate sector versus selection in the armed forces. Okay. So is there any difference at all? Okay. Is there any difference in terms of how the selection happens for the armed forces versus how it happens in the corporate sector?
Yes.
Manoj, are you able to hear me now? Yeah, Manoj.
Yes, sir.
Can you explain to us? I think we've covered this, but for Ajinkya, for Sharvari, you know, for those people who are hearing this for the first time,
yes.
What have we discussed as the essential differences?
So in the SSB, a person is checked for his mental fortitude. Actually, these are the psychoanalytical tests. So it tells that how a person is. And in corporate sector, the professional knowledge of a field is checked, preferably. There it won't be checked that how the person is. So this is a major difference in SSB and corporate sector job selection.
Yeah. So you know, essentially, there's a lot of difference between how people operate in the corporate sector versus how we operate in the armed forces. And because the way that we work itself is so different, I think even the selection criteria becomes very, very different. Okay. First and foremost, you know, Ajinkya, do you think there are any timings at all in the armed forces? And does the corporate sector have any timings?
Sir, timing in the which sense are you talking about, sir?
Work timings.
Yes.
Working hours.
I think that according to what my perception is in defense sector, sir, timing varies according to the position where you are allotted. For example, if you are allotted in the borderline, you need to do your job 24/7. And if you are given some office work, they might have a particular set of timing just similar to the corporate sectors.
Okay. So, I know, honestly, you know, since I have been on both sides, you know, I have worked in the corporate sector also for about 4+ years. And of course, I spent a lot of time in the armed forces in uniform. I think, you know, essentially, I can tell you very confidently that armed forces is absolutely 24/7. Absolutely 24/7. Especially at the officer's level, you are always on call and you always have to be available. Okay. In the corporate world, you may have a 9-to-5 job. Maybe you may feel, okay, I'm stretching, yaar, 9 baje se 5 baje tak timing hai. लेकिन मुझे तो 7 बज जाता है ऑफिस में निकलने से, बट फिर भी 7 बजे जब आप वापस आते हो तब आपको पता है कि चलो अभी ठीक है, अभी आपको कोई डिस्टर्ब शायद नहीं करेगा. ओके, बट दैट रियली इज नॉट द केस इन द आर्म फोर्सेस. ओके, यू विल बी ऑन कॉल्स, यू विल बी गेटिंग रिपोर्ट्स, देयर विल बी पीपल कमिंग एंड मे बी यू नो शेयरिंग सम प्रॉब्लम दैट हैज हैपेंड, बिकॉज एक्टिविटीज आर 24/7. ओके, When you get posted to a ship, for example, okay, and you know, if the ship is in harbor, okay, maybe the routine is a little relaxed. But a warship at sea actually works 24/7. Absolutely. So, you know, you are never, ever, you know, off duty. In fact, I remember the occasions where, you know, I don't know if many of you are aware, but if you are a young officer who is posted to a ship, then you stay on the ship itself. You don't have any accommodation on the shore. And if you are on the ship and if you are an officer, anyone for that matter, but especially if you are an officer, then you are considered to be on duty only. So if something happens, if there is any emergency, whether the ship is in harbor also, and if you are on board, you cannot say ki are mera to duty nahi hai aaj, I am not the duty officer, so let the duty officer handle it. No, if you are on board, then the expectation is that you will pitch in to the extent of whatever is required. You cannot say that, you know, it is not your time of duty, so you are not related. It may happen, some incident may happen, maybe, you know, some emergency may happen, some help may be required, some actions have to be taken. Anyone who is on board is available, and even people who are ashore can be called in the middle of the night to to tackle anything that is required. So it is absolutely 24/7. And you know, you have to understand that it's a lot of responsibility, and it is almost like, you know, you're always you can be called any minute. Okay. Next, of course, is working conditions.
Okay. I'll just like to add an example.
Yeah, Sameer.
Hello, can you hear me, sir?
Yeah, Sameer, we can hear you. Go ahead,
sir.
I can pitch in any time, na? Matlab,
yeah, absolutely.
I'm
yeah.
For the first time.
I don't know
about this room and all. But I just want to add an example to this. It was my early days. I just got commissioned. I was just 21 years old, just out of the academy, and with total different mindset. And within 6-7 days, our unit was told to move to Baramulla, that is Jammu and Kashmir. Okay, and there were two officers who were detailed. So one was a very senior officer, one lieutenant colonel level or major level officer. And the second, I was being the youngest, they said, "Hey, youngster, isko laga do uske saath." And they detailed me also to go along with the team. There were around 25 vehicles with loaded with ammunition, explosives. They have to go to Kashmir. And that was a very difficult time. Insurgency was at its peak that time. So being the youngest and just out of the academy, I was 21 years old. I was very happy because the thoughts that were there in my mind was ki Kashmir jayenge, barf kabhi dekhi nahi hai, scenery binary dekhenge, photo bitto lenge, maza aayega, relatives ko batayenge. I was not at all thinking about my job because I was just a young kid that time. But the senior officer, the other officer who was there with me, he was very worried. He was doing a lot of calculations, looking at the map and all, and I was very relaxed. And finally, the day came. Next day morning, we had to leave at 4 o'clock. That night, my senior colonel surrendered. And suddenly, he called me and told me, hello. So early in the morning, and my senior called me at night and he said, "I have to go immediately. There is a signal. You are the one who's going to take the entire thing, and now you are responsible." So I was just talking about this. Anytime responsibility can come on you, and it is a very common practice when we have war games also. The person who is the in charge, the in charge is no more. So the second person has to take the role. You cannot take it. I don't know anything. I'm the junior most and all. So like 24 hours, there is a problem. To be ready to take on the responsibility anytime. Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Yes, sir.
Yeah. Okay. So, you know, second, of course, is working conditions. Navesh, are you able to see it?
Yes, sir.
Hello.
Yes, definitely. Again, working conditions differ quite a lot. Okay, as Colonel Sameer keeps telling the story about you know, his tenure in the Jaisalmer desert. So you know, working conditions are extremely tough. Mm-hmm. Okay, so unlike a corporate office where you will go and you know you will work from 9 to 5 in an AC office. You could one day be, you know, in the Sachin glacier where there is minus 40 degrees temperature. The next month you could be operating in the deserts of Jaisalmer where it is plus 40 degrees, and maybe, you know, you could also maybe in the next tenure get posted to a nice AC office in the headquarters of Southern Command in Pune. And there is a lot of churn that happens. You have to keep adapting to different working conditions, your you know, working conditions, your office, your environment, the place where you stay, the teams that you lead, everything will keep changing. So timings, working conditions, and because the timings and working conditions are so different from that in the armed forces, even the mental and physical requirements tend to be very, very different. And when we discuss those qualities that we are looking for in the SSB, subsequently, I think we will cover this aspect related to how the physical and mental requirements are very, very different. But if you understand that, you know, the stress levels are going to be a little different. The challenges are going to be a little different when you are working in different environments, without any firm timings, all of those kind of things. Yes, the physical and mental requirements would be very clearly different than what you have in the corporate world. Okay. And, you know, definitely it is not pick and throw. Okay. You understand what is pick and throw? Arnabesh, you are working, na?
No, sir, I'm not working right now.
Arnabesh, you are working somewhere, right?
No, sir, I'm not working right now.
Oh, you're not working now. What is this meaning of pick and throw?
Sorry, sir, I'm not aware.
What do you understand by this pick and throw?
I'm not aware, sir.
You're not aware? Okay, so let me explain, okay? Typically, you know, what would happen is when corporates hire, na, they will hire maybe, you know, I have known of companies like Infosys or TCS, they go to a campus and then they are going to make maybe 300 offers on one campus itself. And, you know, I don't know how many of you are aware, but these companies which are really big like TCS, Infosys, Wipro, most of the IT companies for that matter, they go and maybe they make thousands of offers on campuses every year when the students are passing out. And then many times it happens that after they have got these students into their companies, within 5 to 6 months, you will find that about 20-25% of these students may actually be moving out of that company because reason is that they are not able to cope up, or they don't like the job, or maybe the company is firing them. Many times you have heard of incidences where people will, your own friends will tell you, hey, I'm sitting on the bench, yaar, abhi main bench pe hu. That means that they don't have any work to do, and again, that is also very frustrating. So there are many students who actually leave because, you know, for about 6 months, 8 months, they are sitting on what is called as a bench. And sometimes you're not able to perform. If you're not able to perform, then you are told to leave the organization. And it happens within 6 months, 1 year. Sometimes it happens even at a senior level. But when we are looking at selection and recruitment in the armed forces, that is, I think, the biggest difference. We don't have this pick and throw model. We are not in the business of selecting someone saying, "Achha, chalo, dekh lenge yaar. Agar nahi successful hota hai, to usko hata denge baad mein. Ya usko fire kar denge, usko nikal denge." That is not the philosophy that we have when we are doing our selection process. Hence, when we select, I would say we have one of the strongest selection processes across all organizations. And then I think we also ensure that we train really, really hard. So the philosophy in the armed forces is not pick and throw. It is that we will select very, very carefully. And that is why, you know, we make students stay for 5 days at a selection center. And once we have selected thoroughly, we will train really, really hard, so that by the time the person completes his basic training, okay, he is able to do his job as a good officer. The end product through the selection and training process should be that of a good officer for the armed forces, whether it is in the army or the navy or the air force. And the last point is about what is at stake. I think everyone understands this. In the corporate world, maybe a little bit of profit and loss is what at stake. You make a mistake, maybe the company loses some money, but subsequently they may cover it up. You make a, you know, make something good, the company makes some profits. So it is more of a profit and loss game in the corporate world. But in the armed forces, you are putting lives at stake. Your decisions result in a profit or a loss for the company in the corporate world, but your decisions could result in a win or a loss in battle, and there could be lives at stake. So the decision making process in the armed forces has to be very, very different than the decision making process and the environment in the corporate world. Okay. Any questions till now in terms of whatever we had covered, especially the people who are, you know, in for the first time, like maybe Ajinkya, Sharvari, Arnabesh, Sampanna. Any questions till now?
Sir, did I miss something important in the first 10 minutes?
No, not really, Arnabesh. Not really. Nothing that would make you lose the continuity. I think you're getting this, right?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, okay. Okay. Anyone, any questions?
No, sir.
No, sir.
No, sir. Yeah.
Okay. Sure.
No, sir.
Let's move ahead. Let us talk about the selection procedure as such. Okay. So it is a detailed 5 to 6 days selection process. It has evolved after a lot of trial and errors. We talked about this in the last session also, where we talked about why it is called as a scientific and time-tested process. And many leading, I think India is not the only country which follows this process. There are many leading armed forces across the world that follow this process. Okay. What are we looking for essentially? We are looking for team players, because the armed forces is all about teams. Okay. So, you know, group dynamics is very, very important. And the question often that is asked is individual brilliance not important? How I look at it is that yes, individual brilliance is important, but it matters only if you are a team player. You know, when I'm selecting someone in my team, and armed forces is all about teams, like I said, whether you're on a ship, you're in an aircraft, or you're in the army, in a unit, I would rather take someone who is able to work in a team than take someone who is individually very nice, very brilliant, but is not able to work in a team. So, between individual brilliance and team effort, or the ability to be a team person, I would say it is more important for you to be a team person, a good team person, to be able to do well in the armed forces. And we look for that quite a lot when we do the selection process.